Hey there guys, Paul here from the engineeringmindset.com. In this video, we're going to be discussing the Multi Ejector as well as its application and working principle for transcritical CO2 refrigeration systems. Just before we get started, I want to take a moment to thank our partner Danfoss for sponsoring this video. Danfoss has a new product that has them shouting "We love CO2" from the rooftops to anyone that will listen. They're really excited because using CO2 as a refrigerant is helping to make cooling more efficient and sustainable even in the harshest conditions. Their multi-ejector solution is what makes this possible, and people are saving up to 10% a year on their energy consumption. That number goes even higher in warmer climates near the equator. If you want to learn more about the multi-ejector solution or CO2 as a refrigerant, I recommend you follow the link and head over to multiejectorsolution.danfoss.com. In a previous video, which I'll link to in the video description below, we discussed how traditional HFC refrigerants are starting to be phased out through new laws and regulations because of their damaging effects on the atmosphere and the environment. This means alternative refrigerants are being used, and there's a growing trend to use CO2 as a refrigerant, which is referred to as R744. This is popular because it's a natural, non-toxic, non-flammable refrigerant with high heat transfer and a global warming potential of just 1. Is growing in popularity, especially within supermarket or food retail refrigeration systems, with many R404A and R22 systems being replaced with CO2. Traditionally, R744 has been used mainly in the cooler climates, especially in Northern Europe. And that's because in the cooler climates, it operates very efficiently, whereas in the warmer parts of the world, where the ambient temperature is at or over 27 degrees Celsius or 81 degrees Fahrenheit, we find that historically R404A is more efficient. The reason it has mostly been used in Northern Europe is because the critical point of R744 is very low, at just 31 degrees Celsius or 87.8 Fahrenheit, and a pressure of 73 bar or 7,300 kPa. Whereas R404A has a critical point of 72 degrees Celsius or 161.6 Fahrenheit, and a pressure of 35.7 bar or 3,570 kPa. Therefore, when the ambient temperature is near or above this low critical point, the refrigerant is unable to undergo a phase change and condense into a liquid within the condenser. The cooling capacity of the evaporator is reduced in a standard transcritical system, and higher pressures at the gas cooler are needed to increase the cooling capacity. However, Danfoss has found a solution to the problem and launched the multi-ejector to allow CO2 transcritical systems to operate efficiently even in the harshest conditions. Let's have a look at some simple systems to see where the multi-ejector is located and how it works. A typical, simplified first-generation CO2 supermarket refrigeration system would have a design much like a standard refrigeration system, with the compressors compressing the refrigerant and sending this to the condenser or gas cooler to reject the unwanted heat. By the way, in CO2 systems, you'll often hear the condenser referred to as a gas cooler. That's because, as I mentioned earlier, when the ambient conditions are above the critical point, the refrigerant can't condense into a liquid, so the refrigerant is in a gas form and the condenser only cools this gas down. Therefore, we call it a gas cooler instead of a condenser. The refrigerant then passes through a high pressure control valve, which is controlling the pressure of the refrigerant within the gas cooler. It then flows into the receiver, which separates the refrigerant depending on whether it is a gas or liquid state. The refrigerant, which is in a gas phase, will flow through a bypass line and valve into the suction line of the compressor, where it will repeat the cycle. The refrigerant, which is in a liquid state at the receiver, will flow down and take one of two routes depending on the system design. In this example, the refrigeration system is supplying both refrigerators and freezers, so we have two different pressure lines. The first line is the medium temperature line, which supplies the refrigerators. The refrigerant flows through an expansion valve and into the evaporator to provide cooling by removing the unwanted heat. It then takes its unwanted heat and moves it away to the compressors. By the way, if you want to learn how expansion valves or evaporators work, we've covered these in great detail previously. Just check the links in the video description below. The second line feeds the freezers and is therefore a low temperature, low pressure line. Again, this flows through the expansion valve and evaporator, but this time it enters an additional compressor to bring the pressure up a bit. It will then rejoin the other refrigerant and flow to the main compressor to repeat the cycle. In this design, we have 100% of the refrigerant flow rate coming out of the gas cooler and into the receiver. Around 45% of this will be in a gas state and flow through the bypass, whereas the remaining 55% will flow to the evaporators. The main compressor therefore has to work hard trying to compress 100% of the refrigerant through the system. The second generation CO2 system added a parallel compressor which took the gas state refrigerant from the receiver and compressed this separately. In this design, around 45% of the refrigerant will enter the parallel compressor, while only 55% enters the main compressor. This made the system more efficient because the gas state refrigerant coming from the receiver is at a higher pressure compared to that coming from the evaporator. So less work is needed to be done to bring this back to high pressure for the gas cooler. The main compressor now only has to do work on the remaining 55% of the refrigerant, so it too has a reduced workload. The third generation design and the most energy efficient CO2 system designed to date uses the multi ejector with an AKPC 782A pack controller. In this design, we run a line from the suction line of the main compressor and feed this into the multi ejector. We also take the high pressure line from the gas cooler and feed this in too. These two different pressure refrigerants are going to be mixed together and then fed into the receiver. In this design, the multi-ejector will lift around 40% of the refrigerant from the suction line of the main compressor and mix this with the flow from the gas cooler. 60% of this mix will flow to the evaporator and 80% is going to flow to the parallel compressor. Therefore, only 20% is compressed by the main compressor, which has to work the hardest. The remaining 80% goes through the parallel compressors. Let's have a look at how the multi-ejector works. If we look at the multi-ejector, you'll see we have three ports on the side. The top one is the high pressure inlet from the gas cooler. The middle inlet is the lower pressure intake from the suction line of the main compressor. The bottom port is the outlet where the mixed refrigerant will leave the multi-ejector and head to the receiver. On the other side, we have three pressure transmitters which are being monitored by the controller. On the top, we have a strainer which all of the refrigerant from the gas cooler will enter through to protect the system. We then have 4 to 6 ejectors to control the flow of refrigerant through the multi-ejector. These are controlled by solenoid coils on the top, which are connected to the controller. If we look inside the unit, we see the main parts of the ejectors. The two streams of inlet refrigerants enter the multi-ejector and are held in the headers. The controller will signal one or more solenoid valves to open depending on the capacity required. As the solenoid is energized, it lifts the respective valve needle to allow the high pressure refrigerant to start to flow into the ejector. This refrigerant enters through the top, which is known as the nozzle. The refrigerant then passes through a small contraction within the cross-sectional area known as the throat. This contraction causes the refrigerant to expand. During the expansion, the potential energy of the high pressure refrigerant is converted to high speed kinetic energy. By the time the refrigerant reaches the exit of the nozzle, it's at a very high velocity. As you might know from fluid dynamics, when the velocity increases, the pressure decreases. This reduction in pressure causes a suction as the refrigerant passes across the opening for the second inlet. This suction causes the check valve to open and then pulls the gas state refrigerant in from the suction line of the main compressor. These two refrigerants will then mix together in the mixing chamber or mixing unit. The mixed refrigerants will then enter the diffuser, which is a conical shape. This expansion in cross-sectional area slows the refrigerant down, and so the velocity or kinetic energy is converted to potential energy or pressure. This medium pressure refrigerant then flows to the receiver. Each ejector is rated for a different capacity, so the controller will vary how many and which ejectors are being utilized to provide the optimal performance. Okay, that about wraps things up. Before I go though, I just want to thank Danfoss one last time for sponsoring this video. I also want to remind you to check out their climate-friendly, energy-saving multi-ejector solution over at multiejectorsolution.danfoss.com and find out what has the people over at Danfoss saying we love CO2. Okay guys, that's it for this video. Thank you very much for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this and it's helped you. If so, please don't forget to like, subscribe and share. And if you have any questions, let me know in the comments section below. Don't forget to also follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Google+, and Twitter, and also check out our website, theengineeringmindset.com. Once again, thanks for watching.